The resurrection of Jesus is the central foundation of Christianity. Our faith either lives or falls on this fact. The Apostle Paul laid down this foundation very early on in his first letter to the Corinthians. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of a people most to be pitied. So if Christ has not been raised, there is no Christianity, and all we do is in vain. However, with such high stakes, we are blessed, because the resurrection is the one miracle from history that is more evidence than any other miracle claim. Antony Flew became a deist at the end of his life, but while he was still an atheist, he admitted, "The evidence for the resurrection is better than for claimed miracles in any other religion. It's outstandingly different in quality and quantity." Now, before we can get to the evidence, we need to lay the groundwork. Many skeptics assert that unless we have absolute proof, the resurrection did not happen, and we cannot say that it happened. As usual, that is their right. But mere skepticism and setting the bar extremely high will not challenge an historical case for the resurrection. If all the evidence points to the resurrection and someone doesn't think it is enough because they arbitrarily set the bar so high that it cannot be reached, that will not refute the overall case or offer a better explanation of the evidence or show the evidence doesn't infer the resurrection most likely happened. We can continue on to argue the case for the resurrection without worrying about someone with this level of skepticism. It doesn't really challenge the case or offer a better explanation of the evidence. So how do we build a case, and what is the goal of the resurrection argument? The goal cannot be to demonstrate the resurrection is true in the sense that one can prove something is true through repeating an experiment. The resurrection is an event that happened in the past and cannot be repeated. So the conclusion can only be reached like one proves an historical fact or concludes a forensic investigation. As Aviezer Tucker says, historiography does not reconstruct events. It cannot bring Caesar back to life or reenact the Battle of Actium. Historiography does attempt to provide a hypothetical description and analysis of some past events as the best explanation of the present evidence. One evaluates the evidence and infers to the theory that can best explain the data. This would only prove the resurrection as far as one demonstrates other historical events happened. This is where we propose different theories and see which best fits the data. If a theory cannot fit the data, then it is thrown out as insufficient and not as probable as other theories that can better explain all the data. I also want to say, the only fair way to approach the resurrection is with methodical neutrality, where the one making the claim bears the burden of evidence. If I say that Jesus rose from the dead, then I need to demonstrate such a theory best explains the data and other theories cannot. However, this is a double-edged sword, because if I present a case, an atheist or Muslim cannot just say I am wrong and Jesus did not rise from the dead. He or she would also have to counter my argument with a better explanation of the data of what they think happened and show why the resurrection explanation is insufficient in explaining the data. D.H. Fisher points out the burden in history is always on the one making the claim, but also on the one making the rebuttal or the opposing claim. Of course, one can refrain from making any claims and be agnostic on the issue, but that personal conviction doesn't create an objective argument against someone who is making an historical claim, nor does it challenge or refute the presented argument. If they wish to do that, then they would need to propose an opposing theory and back it up with evidence and a case for plausibility. Last, in arguing for the resurrection, it helps create a better case if we have first addressed three things. These are not necessary to argue the case for the resurrection, but they do help in the overall goal. First, one can supply evidence God exists in formal arguments. Before we argue for the resurrection and infer Christianity is true, it helps if we first have evidence for a general theistic creator, as combining arguments from natural theology with the resurrection argument makes a better and a cumulative case for Christian theism. And since we've already done this, it will help to strengthen our case if there is already evidence that God exists and is capable of causing such an event. Second, it is beneficial to argue for the reliability of the New Testament. Now, when we go over the evidence, we will not assume the New Testament is inspired or accurate in every detail, or even on most details. We'll only argue from the facts that are backed by scholarship and evidence. But we should at least make a case the documents are not completely unreliable and have a good historical case. And since we have completed this as well, it will help our overall argument. Third, we need to show miracles are not logically impossible events. And this was also completed as well. So now that we have given evidence for a theistic worldview, shown the New Testament is reliable, and have established miracles are at least logically possible, we can proceed with the argument for the resurrection, with this as our underlying foundation. Then, we'll follow it up with additional evidence, address competing theories, and refute objections.